To the Atheist Experience. We are live April 18th today, and I am your host, Ashley Perrien. Our co-host this week, Jeff D.
Hi, folks.
Welcome back.
Thanks, man.
We are sponsored by the Atheist Community of Austin, a nonprofit educational organization promoting positive atheism and the separation of church and state. We are having weekly meetings right now every Sunday morning at 11:30 at Crescent City Beignets on West 6th Street, a couple blocks west of Lamar. That's every Sunday around about 11:30, except for the third Sunday of every month when we have our lecture series at the Austin History Center on 9th and Guadalupe. Today we had a lecture, and I believe it was on computer forensics. These lectures aren't always atheist specifically related, just something that's generally interesting to the group. That was a lecture today. I actually missed it. But hopefully, you know, there were some people there who saw it and can perhaps call in and give us a brief update on it. But that is every third Sunday. Like I say, 9th and Guadalupe, Austin History Center, we have our lecture series. As for other things that we do, every Monday night we have Godless Gamers, where we get together, play board games, card games, that type of thing. If you go to our website, www.atheist-community.org. We have a link there to the meetings, and you can get more information and details there. But the gamers, that's every Monday night at 7. Other things, we also have happy hour every Thursday at Antonio's Tex-Mex on the southbound feeder of I-35, just south of 183. That starts around 7:30 and goes until whenever we decide to get out, typically around 10, 10:30, something like that. Also, we have our internet audio show, The Nonprofits, which is every other Saturday at atheistnetwork.com. Jeff D. is the host of that,
yep,
along with Russell Glasser, the producer, and typically whoever ends up showing up, right?
Yeah, we have various guests. And next weekend would be a live show weekend, except that there's scheduling conflicts, and we're not going to have a new live show on that.
Okay, so this upcoming the 23rd, it will be a repeat.
Yeah, but you can always listen to past episodes by going to our website, www.atheist-community.org. Click on the radio link, and it'll take you to a page where like the last six or five or six episodes are there for download on demand.
Yeah. Okay. All right, so the next show is about 3 weeks away then.
Yeah.
So apparently. Okay. All right, that's it for our normal announcements. Welcome back. Again, this is April 18th, and we are a live call-in show. We'll be getting calls a little bit later. We also have an email address, and I'll go over that really quickly. tv@atheist-community.org. If you have any suggestions, feedback, if you're left hanging at the end of the show and we didn't manage to get to you and take you as a caller, go ahead and write to us, and like I say, we'll reply to those online via email. And any of them that any good letters that we get, we'll actually bring them on the air, of which I have two today. But we'll get to those in a couple of minutes. I believe there's one more announcement that you wanted to hit.
Yeah, I wanted to talk about something that is happening here in Austin next weekend.
Yeah, on the 23rd.
Is that correct? Yes, that's the 23rd. That's the 24th and 25th.
Oh, okay, that's right.
At Holiday Inn Austin Town Lake, there's a conference, Defending Science and Reason in an Irrational World. This is sponsored by the Center for Inquiry, which is a tax-exempt educational organization supporting the activities of CICOP, C-S-I-C-O-P, the Committee for the Scientific Investigation of Claims of the Paranormal, and the Council for Secular Humanism. There will be they have a whole list of different speakers, including Paul Kurtz. He's a philosopher, founder, and chair of the Center for Inquiry. He's going to be talking about new threats against reason and how they can be defeated. Amanda Chesworth is the educational director for CICOP and developer of the Inquiring Minds program at www.inquiringminds.org. With experience in both formal and informal educational practices, Amanda will discuss the many opportunities that exist across disciplines and within many sectors of the society for the promotion of critical thinking and skepticism among young people. David Kopsel is the executive director for the Council for Secular Humanism. He's earned a law degree and a doctorate in philosophy at the State University of New York in Buffalo. He is an adjunct assistant professor of philosophy, specializing in legal philosophy, ontology, and ethics. His dissertation, entitled The Ontology of Cyberspace, Law, Philosophy, and the Future of Intellectual Property, was published by Open Court in 2000. Tom Flynn is editor of Free Inquiry magazine, published by CFI. Founder of the Council for Secular Humanism's First Amendment Task Force and director of the R.G. Ingersoll Birthplace Museum. Author of The Trouble with Christmas and Galactic Rapture. He will speak on the rights of the non-religious and secular humanism in society with a special preview of Free Inquiry's next church-state update. Richard Hull is Senior Development Officer of the Center for Inquiry. He holds a PhD from Indiana University, served in the philosophy department of the State University of New York at Buffalo for 30 years, retired in 1997 to assume the post of Executive Director of the Texas Council for the Humanities in Austin. He's the author and editor of numerous books and articles, and he's going to be one of their speakers as well. Finally, DJ Grothy is the director of campus and community programs for the Center for Inquiry. He serves as the director of CFI's On Campus, a secular pro-science alternative to religious extremist and fringe science campus movements. He has traveled and lectured widely throughout North America, speaking on secular ethics, religious political extremism, church-state separation, science advocacy, and skepticism. So those are all speakers that are going to be at this conference. Again, that's April 24th and 25th. It will be at the Holiday Inn Austin Town Lake. For more information, you can call the Center for Inquiry at 800-634-1610. I think we have a number for that. Yeah.
Yep.
And they can tell you all about that. I should mention it's not free.
Okay. All right, yeah, one or two of those people, DJ Grothy, I know, actually was down here, I want to say around November-ish or something like that. I can't remember the actual date. But yeah, he was down here and he actually came on the show that weekend.
That's right.
When he was in town.
That's right.
All right. Okay, as I said earlier, we have an email address, tv@atheist-community.org. And one of the emails we got was regarding last week's show. If you were watching, Karen Glasser was actually on last week, and she was talking about every week, well, most weeks at least, we have the decals and whatever in front of the thing. We also have a flag, which is normally there. She was talking about how we have the flag and how patriotism in general, at least in her mind and how she was looking at it, equates to religion in a certain way, as in blind patriotism, just reciting the pledge every day, not really understanding, not saying it because you mean it, but just because it's what you do. It's almost a form of brainwashing in the same form that religion does things. And so she had some issues with that. Culminating in, at the end of her talk, taking the flag and throwing it off the table.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, anyway, we got an email from one of the viewers yesterday, actually, and surprisingly enough, we didn't get all that much reaction to it. As in, this, we only had one email. The callers were typically supportive of the general message that was being said. We did have one though that had slight issues. He was a Vietnam veteran and said, "I respect the flag. I saw many good people die defending it, and although it is just a symbol, it was important to them and it is important to me." Sorry. Going back to what the email said, she was trying to make a point, and I totally agree with that point. We live in a country based on a constitution which guarantees freedom of speech. A citizen can say they are not a patriot and that they can throw a representation of the flag on the ground and not have to worry about the secret police coming to get them in the middle of the night. They can also equate patriotism with religion if they want to. I disagree with all those things, but I defend her right to say them. Now, I think that's kind of catching the wrong end of the stick of what she was saying, perhaps. The way I was looking at it, and I think the way that she was going after it, wasn't so much that it's a freedom of speech issue as in just blind patriotism. just not thinking about things and just reciting the pledge every day, saying that.
So the may I?
Of course.
May I guess?
Of course. Of course.
So you would say the point is more like, it's fine to support something, but understand what it is that you're supporting.
Of course.
Before you give your support to it.
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly. Understanding that.
I tend to agree with that.
Defending the flag is one thing, and we usually say, you know, I stand behind the flag, I support the flag.
Yeah.
Well, the flag is just, again, cloth.
Yeah,
it's a symbol
that represents our nation.
Exactly.
And, you know, our culture and our legal system and our constitution.
Exactly.
And all of the stuff that makes this, you know, uniquely this country.
Exactly, exactly.
Not all of which is that great, right? But a lot of
exactly.
it is. And certainly, yeah. you know, at least because we're used to it, it seems better to most of us than the alternatives.
Yeah, yeah. Supporting the U.S. in general and seeing that there are good points and there are bad points and trying to make it better, I think, is obviously a very good thing. Blind patriotism and just saying, you know, I don't know any of the facts, but America rocks, and that's all I need to know, is not a good way to be doing things, I don't think.
Interesting.
I would personally never disrespect a representation of the flag the way she did. Not disrespecting something and...
This is a letter again?
Yes.
Okay.
Sorry. Not respecting something and disrespecting it are two different things. I have no respect for the Christian crucifix, but I would not throw one on the ground in front of people who do hold it in high regard. That is just boorish and common. So, anyway, we thank you very much for your response. You did mention it here that I had said that I would be putting the flag up again. I don't actually know if I actually said those words, that I would be putting it up, so I'd think about
it. Are you going to be putting it up
again? I will be putting it up again, though, yes. So, the flag is going back into our place.
What did you hide when you put that up?
I don't know, perhaps we should make a third spot, because that is think. Unfortunately, the only problem with...
they're taped.
Yes, the only problem with that is that that is actually for a Christian... like book publishing company or something like
really?
That.
Really?
Which oddly enough, and actually, if you can get a quick focus on this. Oddly enough, again, it's a Christian publishing group, and their logo and such is Think with an owl.
Yeah.
Which is usually what we're encouraging people to do.
Yeah.
So.
But it's also important to learn how to think well, how to think rationally and clearly that's the kind of stuff they're going to talk about at that conference next weekend.
Exactly. Exactly. So, our flag goes back in place. Hopefully it will stay there without tape. And that is one of the letters. Now, the other one that we got was, I ended up getting into a somewhat prolonged debate over a couple of days with this lady who wrote in, I don't have the original email. But the second email she had went into a couple points and basically saying that we as people have constantly rejected God. When God revealed himself to Adam and Eve, they rejected him. When Noah tried to warn about God's coming judgment, they rejected him. When God revealed himself through Moses, the people of Israel rejected him, and so on and so on and so on.
That's Adam and Eve.
Yes.
Moses and who?
Noah.
Noah.
And when God came to us in the flesh as Jesus.
That's four people.
We crucified him.
Okay.
So.
Who's we, Kamasabi?
All right. So you see, we are naturally rebellious against God. That is why we have a Savior that paid for our sins, since we cannot by nature obey God.
Can I make a comment? I mean, there's all kinds of things people have been asked to believe over the, you know, many
yes.
centuries and millennia of human history.
Yes.
Including things like, the Earth is flat, right?
Yes.
We've been asked to believe that.
Of course.
And we don't believe it now.
Yep.
Does that mean that we are rebellious against the idea that the Earth is flat? It could be, and it is in a lot of cases, that when an idea has, when people have trouble believing something, that there's a darn good reason to have trouble believing that.
Yes.
Just a possibility.
Yeah. And it also goes on here, basically the idea that, you know, we all have a choice in how to live our lives. We can choose these things. If you do something wrong, you will get punished. And then, I this line at the end really twisted me the wrong way. Why would God waste his time physically revealing himself when you will probably reject him anyway? We live by faith, not by sight.
But now, no, speaking for us atheists, we're living by sight over here. Got no problem with that.
Exactly. And also, it almost sounds like she's giving God the permission to have a little pity party for himself.
Huh?
As in, he went through and created the whole universe, created the people, and now they're rebelling against him. And so God, instead of saying, okay, look, people, I'm real, here's the laws, here's the way it's going to work, whether you like it or not.
Uh-huh.
Here's the way it is.
Yeah.
Instead, he's just going to turn his back, sit in the corner and pout, and let us all burn in hell. And have his little pity party.
Oh, come on now. They believe he did something to avoid that outcome.
Well,
right?
Yeah.
That's what the whole Jesus thing is about. But
exactly.
But I understand your point, right? It's like, there's a very simple solution.
Exactly.
If God has a problem with people not believing in him because we don't see him.
Exactly.
That's show up.
Exactly.
Very simple.
Exactly.
Very simple. Any deity worth its salt ought to be able to pull that one off.
And usually,
but we always get this. Well, he did, 2,000 years ago for Jesus. That doesn't count. We didn't see that. There's all kinds of stuff people claim happened 2,000 years ago that we don't believe.
Exactly.
Right?
We have fifth account tales 2,000 years ago by unreliable witnesses of a supposed account of God coming down of a man coming down to earth who claimed to be God.
Yeah.
That's what we have.
Yeah, plus all of the other discarded mythologies of ancient times. You know, they ask us to believe all kinds of things, and, if there were worshippers of Zeus still running around, they could complain that, oh, well, Zeus did reveal himself, just read the Iliad. I'm sorry, that's not good enough.
Yeah.
That is not good enough.
Yeah. So, okay, we still have a little bit more to go over on this,
but
we can go ahead and put the phone number up. Again, we are live. We will be taking calls in a little bit. Phone number 477-2288. Anyway, to continue with this email, let's see, what were some other things that were said here? When God introduced himself to Adam and Eve, he gave them paradise. He made them one commandment: do not eat from the tree of knowledge, because the knowledge that will be revealed to them, they would not be able to handle it. God would reveal this in his good time. Now, usually the problem that we have with that is the tree of knowledge of good and evil is assuming the eating from the tree would give them knowledge of this is good, this is bad, doing what people say is good, generally, doing what people don't say is bad, or what they say not to do is bad.
Okay.
So,
it depends what people.
Of course. It depends on specific situations. But, as a general rule, like when you're talking to kids, you say, when your parents tell you to do something, you do that. That's a good thing. If they say, don't do this, you don't do that, because that's a bad thing.
Okay.
So, they didn't have this knowledge. They had not eaten of the tree of knowledge. So, God comes along and says, don't do that. They have no comprehension of what that means.
Okay.
That can't mean anything to them because they don't know good and evil. They don't know right and wrong.
Ah, I see where you're going with this. Good point.
They don't have a direction to go in, and so, God says, don't do that. Doesn't mean a thing. So when they go
ahead, after they've done it.
Exactly.
And then they were ashamed.
Exactly. Then they realized what we did was wrong.
Right. Okay.
So.
So it's punishing people for laws they don't know anything about.
Exactly.
Which, there's sort of a principle of ignorance of the law is no excuse.
Of course.
But this is a different case, because not only did the God not equip them with knowledge of, the value of the rule that he was setting out for them, right? A knowledge of the idea that you're supposed to actually follow this rule. Not only that, but he, being omniscient, he knew before he even started
exactly
how it was all going to come out.
Exactly.
So, who's at fault here if there's a problem? It would be the guy who knew how everything was going to be coming out and then created it exactly the way
he
planned, knowing it was going to come out that way. That's the guy at fault.
Yeah.
It would seem to me.
Yes. Again, when God created the world, he knew exactly the order of everything that was going to happen.
Yeah.
And so when it follows through, then he gets all ticked off and has a fit. And also, again, we'll cut down a little bit here. Whether you are a murderer, liar, thief, adulterer, et cetera, no sin is greater than the other in God's eyes. Human philosophy tells us that a murderer is far worse than stealing for a living. But both will send you to hell if you do not repent and ask God to forgive you for it in his son's name. Now, again, the problem with that, according to God's judgment, a parking ticket requires the death penalty. There is no fairness in this system.
Wow.
So I cannot agree, and I don't understand how anyone could respect, assuming obviously that they believe, even if we believed, that the God of the Bible was perfectly and absolutely true, I could not respect that God. I could not show any faith to that God or any look up to it in any way, shape, or form. Because if he's going to let me burn in hell for the equivalent of a parking ticket, that's not really fair.
See, this is just another example of how religion deprives people of an actual understanding of what morality, ethics, and laws are for.
Yeah.
Morality, ethics, and laws are for the purpose of helping everybody get along, right? Without too much trouble, without people being too unhappy. That's the point. We make laws, and we arrive at ethics, and we concoct morals in order to try to prevent bad things happening, right? Bad outcomes arising. So, and not understanding that, of course, something like that makes perfect sense, right? Well, yeah. Anything wrong is equally wrong. No, that's not the way it works. Some behaviors are not nearly as bad as others. Some behaviors don't cause nearly as much harm as others. Some behaviors don't cause any harm at all, but kind of creep some people out. And so then they, you know, put together big movements to collect money and try to stop them because it bothers them,
yeah.
When in fact they're not harmful at all.
Yeah.
Sad.
Okay, so that is mostly the email. That's the highlights of that email, at least.
Wow.
But again, our email address, tv@atheist-community.org. If you have any feedback on the show or have any questions that you want to ask us, you can do it there. But again, we are live today, and so if you got a question, call us up with the phone number on your screen, and we will take calls. Now, do we want to get calls, or did you want to go over one or two stories quick?
Let's go with calls
if we have
calls, and if we have a break, we can do some news.
Okay, sounds like a plan. All right, we have got Josh. How you doing?
Yeah, fine. How are you guys doing?
Yeah, pretty well.
Hi.
I have a question for you guys. I've been watching the show for a while now. You guys obviously hate this, so you obviously don't believe in God. What do you guys believe in, and who do you think your creator is?
Whoa, what a loaded question. Who do we think our creator is? The question presumes that there has to be some guy that's our creator.
Yeah, that's what I'm asking.
We don't believe that there was a guy that was our creator.
Where do you think you come from? Do you care about who you are?
I got parents. Is that what you mean?
I know you got parents, and you obviously came from the sperm and all that kind
of
stuff. But who do you think created the earth?
The way you're asking the question is loaded, right? We don't believe that there was a guy that created the earth. So when you ask us who it was, we're going to just shrug and go, what a weird question.
Yeah. As for where things come from and how we got here and how the earth got here, how life evolved,
Exactly.
Again, we have physics and cosmology that tell us how planets, stars, and so forth got here.
Physics and natural laws.
Exactly. We have chemistry that can say this is how life could have arrived. We have evolution that says once you have life, it can go from, you know, simple bacteria to us. We have all these different forms of science that say this is most likely how it happened, or at least here's a really good chance of how it happened. So there is no directly who involved. It's not a who that created the world or life or us or anything else.
Now, my question to you guys is, what if you do find out, like, maybe when you, in the future, you have, like, a divine experience with God or something, would that change your mind? For example, like, the Bible talks about Saul and how he was converted to Paul, and how he prosecuted Christians and was blinded for 3 days. Do you think that if you have such an experience, it will convert you? Because there have been atheist people who have been changed because of a personal experience they had.
I'll go for this first. I'll let you answer in a second. I would have to say I would hope not. The idea, as in, if someone came along and presented some form of evidence that an all-powerful, you know, universe-creating deity exists and he loves me and cares about my sex life, if he actually presented evidence for that, I would like to say that logic would take over and say, okay, whether I like that idea or not, whether I agree with it or not, you know, facts are facts, and that's where we stand, and, you know, I believe that God exists. If it just came through, you know, I'm sitting in bed one night, and all of a sudden, poof, in my head, my God, there must be a God out there. You know, it's just some emotional experience or something like that. I would like to think that, again, in the back of my head, I know that this is just brain chemistry, this is something weird going on. Again, alcohol and drugs have revealed lots and lots and lots of things to lots and lots and lots of people. That doesn't make it true. And so, you know, faulty brain chemistry, I don't want to change my life and start believing things over, you know, a brain fart. So.
My answer is similar. If I had a mystical experience, experience that seemed supernatural, my first response, my first suspicion would be that I was seeing things, that I was hallucinating, that I was misinterpreting what I'd actually seen, or that I was actually, you know, nuts. Because we've got a couple of centuries of very studious, very careful scientific research which hasn't revealed the slightest hint of any supernatural anything existing anywhere. And to throw that all aside because of a momentary personal experience to me seems unwise. I would look for corroborating evidence, and if I couldn't find any, I would brush it off as, you know, as a hallucination or misinterpretation.
Okay. I have a final question before I go, because I know you guys probably have other people waiting. What do you think about the movie that came out with Mel Gibson, The Crucifixion, as it relates to a lot of
Christians?
We didn't
go to see it.
Because I have quite a few friends who actually don't believe in God, who are atheists also.
Yeah.
And actually went to go see the movie out of curiosity, because a lot of people were. The movie has grossed over $500 million so far, knocking
out. It's also grossed over, you know, 500,000 people.
Yeah.
That's a pun. You know,
okay,
it's extremely bloody and violent, isn't it?
People are watching this movie, people who are obviously not Christians, Muslims.
Yeah.
What do you guys think about the movie and the response that is being received? Do you expect a lot of people to be watching it like they are, or you, you know, because there are quite a few people who are not Christians watching it. What do you guys think about that? And would you be, considered watching the movie out of curiosity?
We've seen it.
Yes, yes.
We have seen it.
Have you seen it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
What was your reaction to it?
Ew.
Yeah. Ew? Ow? It seems to me you could make an equally moving, emotionally powerful film out of any mythology you want to name, right? You could take any director who cared to and had the skill to do it could make an emotionally powerful film about anything. So the fact that there's an emotionally powerful film right now that exists that's about Jesus doesn't prove a darn thing.
But you also have to, there are a lot of artists, people like Steven Spielberg, who has made a lot of movies, who is obviously well-respected and have a lot of experience.
Yeah.
But there's been no movie out with such impact like The Crucifixion.
Oh,
would you agree with that?
No, not at all.
No.
Good grief. A few weeks after it first came out, it was dethroned as the number one film by a movie about zombies eating people. And then a couple of weeks after that, it was dethroned by a film called Hellboy, which is about a demon from hell who comes to the earth to be a hero. So I don't think we should overestimate the impact of the film.
Yeah. The movie, I think I heard that it's currently the 8th top movie made. So there are apparently at least seven other movies currently that are doing better at it. I am surprised that it's doing as well as it has, but again, it's an emotional movie that got a lot of hype before it was ever released. So the fact that people are going to see it because, you know, they saw in the news that, you know, it's so violent, it's anti-Semitic, it's about Jesus, it's all these different things that are kind of buzzwords, I'm not really surprised that a lot of people are going to see it. So I'm kind of surprised at the numbers being quite as high as they are, but again, it's a movie that got a lot of hype.
All right. Thank you very much.
Okay.
How often do you guys have your shows on? Because I just saw it right now.
Yep. We are live every Sunday, 4:30 to 6 on Channel 10, and we have reruns every Tuesday, same time.
All right. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thanks, Sean. All right. Let's go on to... Mark, how you doing?
Pretty well. Hi, Ashley. Hi, Jeff.
Hi, Mark.
How you doing?
Doing well. I wanted to give you an update on the math and science textbook proposal.
Uh-huh. Okay, yeah.
We had gotten it into the... We had gotten bills proposed at the state legislature the last two sessions.
Uh-huh.
And
that was to allow kids to keep their math and science textbooks rather than give them back every year.
That's right.
Okay.
And, of course, they would be much less expensive books, as in the Asian countries.
Yes.
Right. And the Asian countries where they have much higher test scores in math and science than we do here, and they let their kids keep their math and science books.
That's right. It sort of is connected, you know.
Yep. Little.
But in preparing for the next session, we have people now proposing resolutions in the two major parties.
Mm-hmm.
And just wanted to let you know that we have those proposals now written into the resolutions at the county level or the state senatorial district level in both parties.
Mm-hmm.
So people who wish to, who may be delegates to the state conventions, will be able to push that idea or promote it to get it into the state level parties. And that would give additional persuade some of the legislators that there is quite a bit of
weight going behind it.
Yes, that's right. Yeah. From the grassroots.
Okay.
The other thing that happened, I recently saw a lecture by Victor Stinger.
Oh yeah, Vic Stinger.
Okay. Yeah.
He is a physicist, mm-hmm. retired. He's an elementary particle experimentalist, and I thought that he did a good job in his talk.
Okay.
Of course, he does, and I read parts of his book too, and I thought he generally did a pretty good job there. Also, there were a couple of finer details, and I did challenge him on one of those regarding time reversal.
Okay.
Oh, you scientists! You're always fighting with each other.
Anyway, I just thought I'd give you an update on those things.
Okay.
Thanks very much.
And I'm enjoying the show.
Okay. Are you back in town right now?
This weekend, yes.
Ah, okay. All right, good. Okay, well, have anything else for us?
Nope.
All right. Thanks a lot for calling.
You bet.
Bye, Mark.
Bye. Bye. All right, that is Mark, one of our members who actually moved up to the Dallas area recently, and every now and then comes back in for a weekend. So good to see you back in town. All right, let's go on to Trent. How you doing?
I'm doing okay, mate.
Okay, what you got for us?
I actually have a couple questions. I'm actually a minister of the Christian faith.
Okay.
And I don't like to knock other religions or knock other beliefs until I have a complete understanding of them.
Okay, good idea.
Is, you know, where a lot of Christians...
Then it's okay to knock them? Oh, I'm sorry.
Go
ahead.
After I get the complete facts about them, then I can distinguish for myself if it's true or false.
That's fair enough.
Of course.
So my questions to you are, is there like, or was there like a driving force that turned your attention against God or to make you just, you know, I mean, were you ever exposed to God in any way, or did you just, from an early age, didn't believe he existed? Or?
All right. I'll start off really quick. You can take over. I was actually brought up Catholic. I went to church every week. My dad brought me. Although I must say that early on, I never really believed all that much. I always had questions and doubts. I never saw any kind of direct proof or evidence of God. And so I always had questions and doubts when I got to like early college age.
Mm-hmm.
I had basically decided that there's most likely something out there because so many people in the world believe in God.
Right.
But I was pretty much convinced that, you know, the Christians aren't right, the Buddhists aren't right, the, you know, Jewish aren't right. There's something, just don't know exactly what it is. And then basically as I thought about it more, read more into ideas and just started looking at actual science, I decided, no, it's a lot of wishful thinking. It's a lot of, you know, it's a good idea. It's a comforting thought, which is why it's so powerful.
Uh-huh.
But in terms of, you know, actual reality, I don't believe that there is any God or anything like that now. So,
oh.
Jeff?
I was raised in the Methodist Church, and my parents, after they retired from their legitimate careers, both became Methodist ministers.
Mm-hmm.
I never felt much in the way of a connection to the religion, but I played along as a kid because it seemed to be the thing to do.
Mm-hmm.
Once I got out of the house and was free to think for myself and make my own decisions, the one thing that I struggled with was this idea that it was somehow disrespectful or dangerous to question. And I remember very distinctly reaching the point in my life where I said, well, any God that I would be willing to worship couldn't possibly have a problem with me taking a good, long, hard, careful, critical look at what I was being told and at the evidence around me and making up my mind. And, boy, it was like within the next 3 days I was an atheist.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, because there was nothing behind it.
So you felt no anchorage in the religion? You felt no anchorage that there was a God?
Anchorage.
No sound.
I'm not even sure what you mean by that. I had no strong emotional connection to it.
You had no soundproof.
Well, no.
Right. Okay. Well, I don't mean to sound disrespectful in any way. But I honestly think that that's speaking out of ignorance.
Okay.
Because if you read in the Bible, which is about the book of life for Christians or anybody that believes in God.
Yeah.
There are numerous occasions where God has allowed people to question him.
Uh-huh. I think you misunderstand me. I'm not saying that I think necessarily that the Christian religion says you shouldn't question.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not saying that.
Right.
But a lot of people that I knew who were religious had that attitude.
Uh-huh.
Right? And I did feel personally, whether it was from the religion or not, I did feel personally like there was some threat or fear or danger or something there that I had to get past.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Wherever that came from. I'm not going to blame Christianity for it.
Right.
I'm just saying, once I did get past it, it's really obvious to me that there was no God within just a few days.
Oh, okay. Well, on that note, actually, when I asked you all, had you ever been exposed to God, you told me that, both of you told me about the church that you grew up in and that you were raised in the church. I'm not going to say I'm a biblical scholar or anything close to it, but I have my own study, you know, I studied it for myself. And in all my studies, I found out that going to church is not always an exposure to God. In fact, it could be a bigger hindrance from God than it is to an exposure, because, as you know, everybody talks about it, you find most of the funniest things, most of the most critical things, you know, most critical people.
So are you going back to the idea of a more of a personal experience?
Not a personal experience, because, you know, God, I'm not going to say God doesn't speak to everybody, but you have to be really blessed for something like that to happen. You know what I'm saying? I'm a minister I've never had nothing.
It could be that there's a God that only reveals himself to certain blessed people. Doesn't change a thing for us.
Right, okay.
As far as we're concerned, we look at those people and say, you know, they're claiming these things that don't seem to have any basis in reality. We see no reason to take them seriously, so we don't.
Okay, but my thing of this is the Bible actually says try God. It says the Bible in the actual words, it says taste and see.
Okay, but the problem there is that we have no. The Bible is leather bound, got some pages in it.
Mm-hmm.
There are millions of books out there
mm-hmm.
that have the same amount of evidence to back them up.
Right.
Including, any fiction book that you care to pick up. We have no reason to believe that this one is any more special than any of the other books out there. So until I get some evidence saying that this God in this Bible is true and real, then I'm not going to take its claims and follow its instructions
right.
any more than I'm going to say that I should be jumping down rabbit holes looking for the Queen of Spades to, bring me to a tea
hearts,
party.
Hearts, man. It's the Queen of Hearts.
Okay, sorry.
Queen of Hearts. Know you're Alice in Wonderland.
Sorry.
Well,
to go looking for, rabbits to have dinner parties with. So,
yeah, okay.
Tea parties with, so.
So you have to be, well, you, I assume that you take the scientific route of us being in our existence and all of this, right?
Try to. I mean, it depends on what you mean by the scientific route, but we see that science has explained a lot in this world and has explained how planets got here, how life evolved, stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
So chances are it's a good thing to rely on to make decisions on.
Okay. My thing about it is this. Even if we take the scientific route, and we believe that somehow, I'm not going to knock it. Like I said, I don't like to knock things. But if there was some kind of explosion that created the planets or some kind of, who created it? There ultimately
has to be some creator.
Yeah.
No, why?
Because,
why?
I mean, things just don't appear. Science has never... explained something just appearing from nowhere.
But what about the creator himself?
The creator himself?
If things don't appear from nowhere, where'd the creator come from?
See, but you can't look at the creator as a thing. Because
why?
The creator is obviously more than a thing.
Well, maybe the universe is more than a thing.
Well, maybe,
Universe is more than a thing, then it's off the hook for having to have been created just like your God is. And so... what you do when you bring in a god to explain it is you violate a principle called, this is a rational principle called Occam's razor,
mm-hmm.
which says if you don't make up additional details to put into your explanation that aren't needed,
mm-hmm.
and once you've admitted that there can be something that doesn't have an origin, right, that didn't get created,
right.
Once you've admitted that there can be such a something,
mm-hmm.
then there's no reason that the universe can't be that something. You don't have to put a God in there. Putting a God in is just an extra step that's completely unnecessary.
True. True.
So
okay.
There you go.
This is my thing about it. Is, okay, even if that is true, then, where does the power, even looking at science, science says that sleep is a stage of death. Science says that.
What?
What?
That what?
Sleep is a stage of death. It's like one of the early stages of death. When you're sleeping, that is a stage of death. It's not death.
I'm not familiar with this, and I need some citation from scientific literature to accept that. But
you can look it.
Okay.
But
go on.
Okay. Now, assuming that I'm true for the conversation's sake.
Sure. For the sake of argument.
Okay, then where does, if it's a stage of death, do you believe we have the power to wake from a death? Do you believe that we have the power to raise the dead by a shake?
Not yet, but medical science is coming along.
Nice.
Yeah, I mean, again...
No, really. I'm very hopeful that medical science will solve this annoying aging and dying problem that we're facing, that evolution has foisted on us.
Well, I mean, okay, I'm sure, because most people that don't believe in God have a thorough knowledge of the Word, the Bible. Most of them do. I mean, because I've ran into people who don't believe in God, but they can tell me more scriptures than I know as one of his closest followers, a minister.
Okay.
So, if you looked at the Word, do you read the book of Revelations, which I'm sure you probably get this a lot?
I have read bits of the Bible, including bits of that.
Of Revelation.
I will not claim to have read the whole thing straight through.
Yeah.
I haven't.
Well, I mean, I give this to you as an assignment. You don't have to accept it, of course. But okay. I'm saying,
hold it. Me and my get my pen. Go on.
The Book of Revelations. Read it in its entirety.
The entire Book of Revelations. Yeah.
Yes.
And what do?
Because when you read it, you realize that it really summarizes the modern day.
Prophecy. Ooh, boy, I wish I had these handy. There are some websites out there that, I don't have the URLs. Can you, if you watch the next show, I will make sure they have this information for you. There are websites where back around 1998, 99, when the millennium was about to happen, and there were a lot of claims that the rapture was going to be upon us, Jesus was going to return, because it was a big, scary round number. There were a lot of websites that cataloged all these claims and, like, noted when the date that was predicted that, oh, it's going to be February 14th, 2000 is going to be the end. And when that day would come and that person who made the claim was wrong, chalk it off. Well, there's one really great site that went backward. They went into historical references, right? People have been predicting the end times are near. Well, since Jesus himself, who told his disciples that the ones standing right there were not going to die before it was all finished, okay?
Before he was, what was all finished?
Don't ask me to quote it exactly. Yeah, you will not taste death before the kingdom arrives. Something like that. It's pretty clear to us. You guys can spin it however you like. It's pretty clear to us. Jesus thought the world was going to end within the lifetimes of the disciples. But even setting aside Jesus, right? Going in the year 120, there were people predicting it was the end, right? In the year when the year 1000 was rolling around, there were people predicting that was going to be the end. All through history, people have looked at the Book of Revelations in particular and said, "Ooh, this vague thing that it says here in the Book of Revelations, this is hinting at, this is showing, this is just like the thing that's happening now." And they've been wrong for 2,000 years.
You say the vague, it actually gets very detailed.
No. I know enough about the claims in the Book of Revelation.
Yeah, we've seen, you know, a big
what about the, like, four-headed dragon thing in there? I mean, there's, well, what about the four-headed dragon?
I don't understand what you want to know about it.
Is there going to be a four-headed dragon, or is that a metaphor for something? If it's a metaphor for something, there's not literally going to be a four-headed dragon, you know, bashing its way through cities like Godzilla through Tokyo. If there's not really going to be a four-headed dragon, then it's a metaphor, and that means it's vague. It means it's subject to interpretation.
Right, but there is.
And that's the kind of stuff that all through history people have been reading in the Book of Revelations.
But that's not a metaphor.
And leaping to... It's not a metaphor?
Okay, so
then
there's actually going to be a scaly four-headed dragon that can, you know, tromp around.
I mean, as my personal belief is that if the word says it, it will happen.
Oh, wow. Because that's going to be cool. I'm looking forward to that.
No, but this is the thing. This is why I say that that's a metaphor. That's not a metaphor.
All right, man. When?
I mean, I don't
in the
know
next
that.
How many years?
I don't know that. I'm not a prophet.
Come on. You're saying the Book of Revelations is showing that it talks about the current times. What? Within 100 years?
But the thing about it is the Bible also tells us that it says my logic is not your logic. My ways are not your ways. In fact, they're much higher than your ways. I'm paraphrasing, but that's
I'm not buying that. Yeah. If it doesn't make sense,
even if
I
were to give you a prediction, that would be from my mind.
But I'm not asking for a date. I'm not asking for a date. You know what? Here's how.
And we're giving you a little leeway here.
Let me phrase the question this way, right? You got to have some idea for yourself, right? If the Book of Revelations is talking about our times now, right? You've got to have some idea in your head. Boy, you know, this must mean that it's all gonna, you know, that Jesus is gonna return within X amount of time.
No.
Whether it's 10 years, 100 years, there's got to be some number. No?
I honestly don't have a number in my head.
Well, then why are you bringing up the Book of Revelations if you don't think it's likely that it's going to occur
within 100 years? I never said anything was unlikely. I just said I don't
Do you think it is likely that it'll happen within 100 years?
I'm not saying. I'm not going to take a stand on that point, on that
number. That's the thing. That's the thing. Because that's another thing that I learned reading these historical accounts of claims of the end times that failed.
Mm-hmm.
The people that claimed the end times were upon us when the date that they claimed it was going to happen passed, they never give up the religion. Never, never, never. They never take a good hard look at themselves in the mirror and say, I've been an idiot. I've been believing this stuff, that it was all going to happen real soon, and then when it didn't happen real soon, you know, I just kept on believing.
Wait a minute. You believe there's no natural... You believe that there's no supernatural being.
Right.
We do not believe that there are any
supernatural... I'm going out on a limb. Okay. I believe there's no supernatural beings.
Okay.
You believe... Okay.
Anything you can show me actually exists, I'm going to say it's natural.
I mean, okay, well... my thing about it is this. If there's no supernatural being, in which I'm sure you get this argument all the time, but if there's nothing after in the afterlife, if there's nothing there...
If we just die.
Right.
Yeah.
Why not? I mean, because you're taking a gamble. Whether you think it's a gamble or not.
Oh. You're talking about Pascal's wager. Are you familiar with that term?
No, sir.
Okay. The idea that Pascal was a mathematician... Mm-hmm. and Christian, who came up with a relatively famous argument in favor of Christianity called Pascal's wager.
Mm-hmm.
He basically graphs out, right, there's two possibilities. There is a God, or there isn't a God,
mm-hmm.
and then there's two choices. You believe in him, or you don't believe in him.
Mm-hmm.
And he showed that, mathematically, you're better off going ahead and believing that there is one, hoping for the big prize of eternal life, right?
Mm-hmm.
The problem is, Pascal's wager doesn't work, because there's thousands of different gods that people have claimed over the course of human history.
Mm-hmm.
There's no particular reason to assume that the only one you gotta think about is the Christian God. No reason at all. So,
not to cut you off, I'm sorry, but...
Yeah.
On what you just said, that all the other gods that exist.
Well, no, that people have claimed.
Right. Did you say that people claim to have existed or do exist?
Yeah.
Okay, if you take up that belief, or you take it up and say, I'm going to wager, so I'm going to do Pascal's wager, as you said, I'm going to take one. Yeah. Now you have to go into a field. As a human mind, we have to know, you know what I'm saying? We have to see. Before we believe, we have to, you know, get a mental logic before we ever just go out on a limb.
But, you know, I wish that was true, but clearly, since, like, over a third of the Earth's population believes in Christianity, mm-hmm. clearly a vast majority of people are able to go ahead and believe without any evidence at all.
Well, I mean, that's true. That's true.
But, you know, I wish that we were all really rational and careful
but looking at you now, looking at you as a person, I can understand that you like knowledge, you know what I'm saying? That you like...
Like knowledge?
No, I mean that you like...
Why are we limiting this to me? Do you like knowledge or don't you?
Yeah, I like knowledge.
Okay.
See, but I mean, I can't do it no
me. It is better to actually believe than to just
guess. Looking at me.
All right.
Okay, if I'm going to do this, if I was in your position, you know, yep. I was an atheist, yep. and I don't believe in God, but okay. I'm going to do Pascal's wager, and I'm going to take up one. I'm going to go research all of the gods, and if you research all of them and look at all of their books, the Quran, the Bible, and all of them, you'll find out that the only one even close to our logic, you know, close to making sense to us, is the God that I serve, God. No, and seriously,
saying,
because
by saying you're a minister?
Huh?
Didn't you start this by saying you're a minister, or is that the last caller?
No.
Are you a minister?
I'm a minister.
You're a minister.
Okay.
Isn't that your job, to say stuff like that?
No, I'm not taking
your word for it.
That's what I'm saying. The research, if you actually go in and research.
Yeah.
Like, you know, Buddha. Buddha was
makes way more sense to me than Christianity.
Really?
Buddhism makes way more sense.
Explain.
Buddha was a guy sitting under a tree.
Uh-huh.
He thought carefully about stuff.
Uh-huh.
Right? It was not a guy who claimed to be the son of God. He was a guy. Now, I know that human beings exist. I don't know that any sons of gods exist. So right there off the bat, I'm way more likely to believe that there even was a Buddha than I am likely to believe that there was a Jesus.
Of course, Buddha existed. According to history, he existed. But they reverence him as a god.
Actually,
I've done a little bit of research on this. Some Buddhists do something like that, yeah.
Okay.
But a lot of them don't, and his original teachings were nothing like that. His original teachings, he was just a guy with some advice.
Okay, well, then once you take that angle, the only God that exists is this one, because we call him God. Muslims call him Allah, which is...
No, I'm not buying that either. it's certainly true that there are historical branchings between Judaism, Christianity, and Islam, right?
Mm-hmm.
But not between Christianity and the worship of the Norse gods, the Norse pantheon of Odin, Thor, and those guys. And there are still worshippers of those guys if you go to Scandinavia. And probably here in the U.S. too, I'm sure you can find some, but they exist. There are people who still believe that stuff. Just because they're, I think that this is an unfair argument that Christians make a lot. They make this argument, only Christianity makes the most sense. It's easy to say something like that when you're in our culture, where your religion that you're talking about and claiming that's the only one that makes sense is the most common religion in our culture, and everybody's used to it. In countries where they believe that the God is this, like, dog-headed jackal man, I'm making this up. I don't know that there's any such place. But there's places out there with gods that are
ancient
wacky,
Egypt.
Right? Weird, wacky gods like that. Those gods make more sense to those people than your god does to them. Why? Not because their god really makes more sense, or your god really makes less sense, because they're more used to it. That's from the culture they grew up in.
Mm-hmm.
And, and in our culture, we're used to hearing about Jesus.
True.
But there's a lot of wacky stuff in the Bible. Talking snakes and all this other stuff. You're telling me there's going to be a four-headed dragon rampaging around the world?
No, I did not say that.
Was that the last guy? I'm sorry.
No, that was me. I said that
you're saying it's not a metaphor.
A literal dragon.
There's literally going to be a four-headed dragon. Isn't that what you said?
Not a dragon, a beast.
Okay, beast. Oh. A four-headed beast. You're telling me there's literally going to be a four-headed beast rampaging around.
Okay,
Now, if you want to go back to something like that, again, look at herpetology today. Multicephalism is very, very common in reptiles. Having a two-headed snake,
I'm sure that's
pretty
not
common.
What he means.
So if you just want to go down to a four-headed snake, there have probably been them out there for the last 5 million years.
You know what else? I've heard the argument that only Christianity can be a source of, like, morality and rules of right and wrong, or that only Christianity can make people happy.
Not true.
Okay, good. I'm glad you don't take it. Because that strikes me as the same kind of argument. It's like everybody's used to Christianity, so it seems more natural when you come to people in our culture and say things like that about Christianity. It seems like, that whole Allah thing seems really out there. But that's only because I wasn't raised in Arabia.
No, actually, Allah is God.
Okay, fine.
Well, then Buddhism set that aside, the jackal-headed creature thing that they have in some little country. I mean, I have no experience with that. I've got no familiarity with that. So if you toss, the Christian God and that God in front of me, one of them's going to seem more understandable.
Okay.
But only because of the culture. Arguments for him make any more
you're
sense.
You're obviously not biased to our surroundings. You're obviously not biased to them. They don't matter to you.
Well, we try not to.
Because I'm
biased,
saying, if Christianity is more comfortable to us to believe, or that it's just the religion that a lot of us just like to take because it's normal,
yeah.
And you're not Christian, obviously you're not affected. It doesn't affect you to the point where you feel like you have to believe it.
The only difference is I've recognized it for what it is.
Okay. Now, this is why I say this, because of your arguments and you know what I'm saying? I really enjoy talking this, but I'm going to end the conversation like this.
Yeah, I think Ashley would probably like his show back, too.
I encourage you to, if you're going to do shows like this and you're going to, promote atheism and things like this, and try to reach people and show them in your perspective what Christianity really is, or what believing in a supernatural being really is. If you're going to expose it for what it is, I encourage you to do it out of knowledge. I encourage you to get a full understanding of it before you do.
What do you think
that
we don't
Bible
understand?
That you have on your desk, I encourage you to actually read it a lot. You know, I'm not saying like you don't read it. I'm just saying I encourage you to look at it.
Yeah.
In its entirety, and like actually try to understand it. You know what I'm saying? Even
okay,
if,
yeah.
But and, see, because when you
can
do
I make
that,
one last point?
You know what I'm saying? That's like a history teacher teaching.
Yeah,
off
but
of,
hold on.
He reading
but
the
hold
history
on.
Book every
but
month.
But hold on. You know what it would prove if I came back on the show next month? Because I'm only on once a month. If I came back on the show next month and said, I read this book. I sat down. I read it all the way through between then and now, and I've decided now I believe in the Christian God. You know what that would mean? In an ultimate sense of like proving anything, it would mean nothing, not anything.
Uh-huh.
Just because somebody reads a book and then they believe something different doesn't prove anything.
I'm not pushing Christianity on you. Is what I'm saying. I'm not gonna try and make you be a Christian. You know
then,
saying, or try to force you to look at Christianity different.
Well, then what's the point of reading it?
Yeah,
no,
what was the point of this exercise?
If you're going, like I said earlier, I don't knock things until I have a full understanding of them.
I have
so
a full understanding of
Christianity.
Okay.
I have a full understanding
of Christianity. I was raised a Christian.
Yeah.
I didn't become an atheist until I was 23.
Yeah. In the Bible,
I was well an adult
and understood what it was I was being asked to understand.
Yes,
I have a full understanding
of Christianity.
Because
you were raised in the church doesn't give
I
you a
have
full
a,
understanding.
No, 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 no. There is a lot more to it. We have been reading about
Does
this
it,
stuff
did
for
years. Did it ever occur to you, sir, that somebody could understand your religion and still not buy it?
True, true.
I understand your religion, and I don't buy it.
Yes.
And I find it insulting that you're. I do find it insulting that you think that the only reason I don't agree to be a Christian is because I haven't read your holy book enough.
See, no, but you're not understanding what I'm saying. That is not. That
yes,
has nothing
I know.
To do with
what your point is, and let me just rephrase here, just to make sure I'm right here, is if we're going to be on TV saying that Christianity is wrong and you know it's got bad things in it, we should read the Bible to at least know the positions. Is that correct?
Come again?
Okay. If we're going to be on TV saying Christianity is wrong, we should read the Bible to at least know the positions.
Right.
Okay. The point there is there are other ways to understand the positions than simply reading the Bible. The Bible is a very convoluted way to get to it. Now, reading it is important. I will grant you that. Actually going back to it and, you know, looking at certain points of it, very helpful, very useful. No doubt about it. However, there's a lot of other problems with it which aren't directly, you know, it's not in John's 3:29 or something like that. That point is bad or something like that. It's that the whole underpinnings that there is some omniscient, you know, universe-creating deity out there who created man, got all pissed off at us for whatever reason, sent his son down, made us kill his son so that he could then forgive us for doing the bad things which he knew we were going to do in the first place.
Yeah, that makes no sense.
There are simply logical and philosophical and moral problems with this.
The thing that you're not understanding is according to my belief, God, his thoughts are higher. Because it makes no sense to you doesn't mean it didn't make sense.
So then basically we have no way of comprehending it.
I object to the very concept that we have to set aside logic as we understand it.
Mm-hmm.
Because you claim, you and people like you, claim that there's some better logic that's beyond us. And that makes it true even if it makes no sense to us. I can't believe you have the audacity to make a claim like that. How dare you tell human beings to believe your religion because there's some other better logic that they can't grasp. How dare you trick and lie to people like that?
Until you can present...
That's disgusting.
Until you can present some other form of logic and some better ways of looking at the world and some better ideas of working with facts, then we have no reason to believe. We have tools of logic and morality and all that kind of stuff to go along with it that make a lot of really good sense.
Mm.
Until someone else presents a different way of looking at it that works better, other than just saying, it works better, trust me, we're going to stick with what we got.
Yeah.
I mean, I understand, by the way,
if there's this higher logic that's beyond us, it's beyond you too, right?
Right.
Well, if it's beyond you two, how do you even know that it exists?
See, because I have a thing called faith.
Ah! Faith. That's that just going ahead and believing, even though it makes no sense, right?
But you know, I did not...
No, I completely understand faith.
No, you know.
Faith is believing, even though it doesn't really make any sense.
That's in your perspective.
Lack of evidence.
And now
define
we're back to
faith
this special logic, this special secret logic that we can't personally experience.
What is your idea of faith?
It either makes sense or it doesn't, sir.
Yeah. What is your idea of faith, then? If it's not just believing, you know, despite lack of evidence, what is your definition of faith, I guess?
My definition of faith is well, according to the Bible, faith is evidence.
No, faith is not evidence. No. Now, the Bible may say that. Faith is not evidence. Just believing isn't evidence of anything.
Evidence is something...
Okay,
because
I can
introduce you to a man down at the sanitarium who believes he is Napoleon, and he's not Napoleon. Believing doesn't make it so.
Okay, but...
So if that's what faith is, you're very deluded.
Okay, I mean, this is what I'm...
We're at the core of the issue here now, right? This is the core of the issue. This is what is wrong and sick and twisted about religion in general, and in our society, Christianity in particular. This whole idea that we should... That if you can get yourself to believe, that's proof that it's true. That's nonsense. Just because you can get yourself to believe something doesn't prove a thing. You know what proves things? Actual evidence. Evidence you can look at, show to others, interpret, test, and show that it comes out the same way next time. What science does, that's evidence and proof. Faith is nothing like that. Faith is just believing because you decided you're gonna.
Right. I made the decision.
And that's fine. You, of course, have a complete freedom to believe whatever you want.
Right,
and I
so
support
you're saying that.
That
it's sick and twisted that I
think it's sick and twisted that you're in the business of telling other people to do the same. I think that's sick and twisted.
Why? They have
because
according to you, remember, we're all these smart people and we all have logic. So
yeah, and
if
your
they
job,
think with the
and
logic,
your job
they'll come up with the reason that
job,
it's not worth believing in. So why can't I talk about it?
Yeah.
Your job as a minister is to get people...
No, see, you're speaking out of ignorance, I know.
Your job as a minister is to get people to set aside their logic, like you have told us to do, to set aside their grasp of reality and believe what
you
tell them.
So you could get a grasp of it.
No,
because if I stood here and I told you to do 30 things, and you know, if I said I was Catholic and I told you to say 40 rosemaries and you're forgiven, that would be pushing. I said to read for yourself and get an understanding so that you can distinguish whether it's worth your time or not.
And we explained to you that
we
explained to you there is enough stuff about Christianity to show us. To show any rational person that it's a load of nonsense. Without reading the Bible.
Again, going off of what you said, this is why I said to read the Bible. Because going off of what you said, if I ever have an issue with anything, the first thing I want to do is go to the core of the issue. If you're finding out things about Christianity, the first thing you should do is go to the core of Christianity. Go to the Bible.
Yeah.
Get a full understanding of the root of Christianity. Yeah. Get a full understanding of what we understand.
Most of us understand Christianity.
Christianity.
And I
because
told you that I understand Christianity.
Everything.
And if you're going to come back to me and tell me I don't, that I must not understand it because I don't agree with you, then I'm going to tell you you're being insulting.
We have read and
studied. I was a Christian long enough to understand what it was I was being taught.
Exactly.
No.
We understand the culture, we understand the beliefs and the ideas and, you know, how things work in the Christian worldview and the stories behind it and stuff like that. We understand all of that.
And my objection to what you do, sir, for a living, is that it is your job to get people to set aside their own grasp of reality. You think it's limited, right? You think there's something better. I don't. I think that a person's understanding of reality is as good as it's going to get.
So
and
if,
you're
if,
asking
if
them
that's
to
as good
set
as it's
going to
get, then why does it differ
aside?
So much?
You're asking them to set that aside and believe what your religion teaches, not because
I'm
of anything you can actually explain.
The Bible says taste
and see. I do want
now,
to get this point
because
out.
You don't believe in God. You don't believe in God. And because you don't, if you taste and see, See, because the only thing that can come of that, of you tasting and seeing, if you don't believe in God, is a new level. It's something God proving to you that I exist. That's the only thing that can come of that.
I think I explained earlier that if I had a mystical experience, my first reaction would be that I was...
No, I didn't say mystical experience. I said God proving that he exists. God can do that in more ways than appearing.
No, sorry, not to me. I happen to know that the way you prove something is by actually, you know, demonstrating that it exists. Not by innuendo, not by hints, certainly not by setting aside your own reasoning faculties.
Okay, look at this. This is why
you cut
I say
me
there's
off
a
every
logic
time I try
we
to
don't
make
understand.
That point. You
okay.
cut me off every time I try to make that point.
Okay,
could you please let me make my point now? Your job as a minister is to get people to set aside their own grasp of reality and believe what your religion teaches, not because of anything you can really explain, but because of faith. Because you tell them, if they can just convince themselves that it's true, then that's proof that it's true. And I think that's terrible.
I didn't tell them anything.
I think that is a terrible thing to do for a living.
Oh, I mean, that's a person. This is my thing. Okay, if reality is reality, right? If your mind grasps it as reality, it's reality, right? If you look at something...
No,
test that your arms
are...
Ask
that guy down in the sanitarium. He thinks he's Napoleon. Is he?
But that's his reality. If he thinks it, then it's reality to him.
He experiences himself as Napoleon. Is he Napoleon?
Not to us, but to him he's Napoleon.
And that's reality then? No,
that's reality
to him. The reality is
he's a
guy in a sanitarium.
See, but you choose to accept a different reality.
There is one reality where stuff actually happens.
Okay, we're going to go on. Going to go on to the next call. We thank you for calling. But in our eyes, reality is something objective and outside of your own brain.
Well,
and so what I see as reality, what you see as reality, and what the guy in the sanitarium sees as reality, while they may be you may be seeing different things, there is an objective one out there.
Yeah. Reality
and
is that
we
which
like
does
the objective
not change
one.
Regardless of what your opinion of it is.
Exactly.
That's what reality is.
So, okay.
So,
well,
listen.
I just hope that you guys are right, because if you're not, you're going to face a punishment.
Okay, punishment.
No,
let's not even go there.
Leave with the threat of eternal torment.
No, I didn't say
thanks.
That. No, I said, of course you did.
Listen, hang on. TV@atheist-community.org. If you got more points, send them there. We'll respond to them online. We're going to get on and take the calls.
Do you have to set aside your own reasoning faculties. Bye. Do you have to set aside your own reasoning faculties and believe something he can't prove just because if he can convince you that if you can convince yourself that it's true, it must be. Not only that, but if you don't, then you get to be tortured for eternity.
Yep.
There's the kicker.
Okay. Now, can I have my pen back?
Yeah.
And we're getting you the decaf next week.
And the show.
Good grief.
All right. We have got about another little less than 20 minutes left. Again, phone number will come up on the screen soon. TV 477-2288. And we will continue taking calls. That one went on for quite a while.
Yeah, it did. Sorry.
But thus the decaf. Okay. Mike, how you doing?
Hi, guys.
Hey.
Hi, Mike.
Is this still Sunday? I guess I would like an assignment for the previous caller. Since he has done such a thorough research of all the religions and he's looked at things objectively, if he could send you guys a synopsis of why he has chosen Christianity versus Islam versus Judaism versus believing in Zeus versus all these myths or whatever.
Yeah.
Write you guys and sit down point by point why Christianity is true and all these other religions are false. Since he has done this objectively,
but Christians do stuff like that. I've seen those kinds of explanations.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, you know, and I know he hasn't done this. I'm just calling his bluff. I want him to sit down and write it down what he's done, and he hasn't done squat.
Yeah. And with a little bit of research, you could do the exact same thing of why. You know, the ancient Egyptian gods of Osiris and Ra and so on makes so much more sense and explains so many more things than God of the Bible does.
Yeah.
A little bit of research, you'll get there.
Yeah. Now, he also claimed that Allah and God are the same God. That is not true. Again, the Christian God sent Jesus down. Allah did not. There's a distinct difference. They are not the same gods. So what he says are the same, again, he's just... But speaking out of ignorance.
Isn't there some kind of historical connection way back in their roots?
Right. They basically started, they're supposedly the same, but again, once some people believe this God did something, other people don't, it becomes a different God. It's just like if somebody is red hair, somebody is a blonde.
True.
It's different.
Yeah.
And again, you know, for Christianity, there are so many flavors of Christianity. Catholics have certain beliefs. Methodists don't. Protestants don't. They really believe in different gods. The Christian God says you cannot get divorced. I mean, the Catholic God says you cannot get divorced.
Yeah.
Baptist gods say, yes, you can get divorced. And again, this guy, he says, to read the Bible and you'll find the truth. So I would like for him to explain to me the truth. Out of the Bible says I can own slaves. Why is that a moral system? Why can I beat my slave? As long as he can get up and walk around after 2 days of the beating, it's okay to do that.
Yeah.
Why is that morally good?
Yeah.
Why can I go out and stone a person picking up sticks on Sunday?
Yeah.
Why is that morally true?
Yeah.
Why can I take my disobedient child to the elders and have him stoned to death?
The one I like is actually if somebody rapes your daughter, they can buy her for, I think it was 50 shekels. And I looked up the exchange rate. That's 12 bucks.
Yeah, I don't think it's that he can. I think that's the law. If a person...
$12 might have been a lot of money back then.
Yeah. True, true.
But still.
I don't think it's he can. I think he has to. I think that's the law. If you rape a virgin, you're supposed to pay the father 50 shekels and you marry him. You can't get divorced. Again, another thing is, I married a divorced woman, and again, that's committing adultery according to the Bible.
Yeah. Yeah.
You commit adultery, you should be stoned. Why should I be stoned?
Yeah.
I subsequently divorced her. So again, another adultery charge. I should be stoned again.
Yeah.
But this is irrelevant. You know, the stoning, that's fine. To me, the big one is eternal torture.
Yeah.
That, for me, you know, to all that other nonsense about how to live your life. If the religion tells you that if you don't agree with them, if you don't believe what they teach, then you are going to be tortured forever.
Mm-hmm.
That,
and you
for me,
deserve
is the
this.
Sticking point.
Yeah. Like, you know,
I kind of react badly to being told that I deserve to suffer eternal torture.
Yeah. Now, I'm a father of two kids, and I can't imagine anything they would ever do where I would say, okay, because of that, you deserve to be tortured eternally.
That's
exactly
right. Yeah, but according to this guy, the email that
we had said basically
if you stole
all
a candy bar,
sins,
you deserve eternal torture.
Yeah, all sins are equal in God's eyes. So according to God, parking tickets deserve the death penalty.
Yeah.
I don't agree with that.
Yeah, and you know, that email, she says something about we're rebellious against God. And one thing she lists is that we crucified Christ.
Yeah,
and then she turns around. Christ gave his life for us.
Yeah.
Did we rebel by crucifying, or was he...
Did we take it, or did he give it?
...sacrifice for our sins? Now, what is it?
Yeah.
It's kooky, isn't it?
Yeah.
Kooky.
And I guess my last thing is, at the end of last week's show, we had a woman called in, and she basically, she said she didn't believe in God. She was angry with God.
Like yes.
She found a Bible in her garage, so therefore that was a sign.
Yeah, she had that personal experience.
That's so sad.
Now, one thing she mentioned specifically was she was angry at God, and she asked him about all these kids who are starving over in Africa. They're starving to death with these, you know, flies on them, starving to death. And then, I found a Bible in my garage, I believe. How does finding a Bible in your garage, how does that placate you with all these people starving to death?
Yeah. Now, again, in her defense, there was a bit more to it than that. But again, it was a similar idea of just having a personal experience that, you know, God reveals himself to you through, you know, your own, you know, brain chemistry.
But some people have extremely low standards of what constitutes a personal experience.
You know, I think like Russell called in pointing out that she believed in God, and she was looking for any kind of sign. Again, she's a believer in any kind of sign, even though, again, she had questions as to why this all-benevolent God would let people starve to death, but somehow finding a Bible in her garage made all the starvation okay.
Yeah. She had basically said that she didn't believe, but she was asking for, you know, just give me a sign.
Yeah.
Well, you got to kind of believe to be asking for a sign.
Exactly.
So you got to be asking something.
Right. Yeah. Right.
And to me, it's incredible. It's incredulous that finding a Bible in your garage just automatically makes all these kids who are starving okay. You don't question that anymore.
Yeah.
It just makes
some of the moral problems that we have with the existence of God that kind of goes beyond what the Bible says.
Yeah.
So.
And getting back to this previous caller, again, I'm with you, Jeff. It infuriates me. He says, read the Bible and you'll believe. To me, if you read the Bible...
That's technically not what his point.
He was saying, he was trying to basically get us off the air. That's my interpretation. He would like us to stop having a show, please. And his argument is, because we are not Bible scholars, we got no business commenting on Christianity.
Yeah.
Well, you know what? It occurs to me, he comments on stuff like cosmology, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Has he read Stephen Hawking? Yeah. I think not. You know, he makes it his business to comment on other fields where he has not read all the literature. That's okay to comment on a field not without having read all the literature, as long as you do understand the subject you're talking about. And I understand this subject.
And to me, the biggest proof against Christianity, the biggest proof against any God based on Christianity, and again, there are millions of them, is the Bible. The Bible has so many things, again, all these stones you're supposed to stone for just the slightest infraction. How can anybody believe that's moral, this all-loving God? How can any all-loving God
Because they are able to selectively choose that this passage here is okay, but this one back here is not. And they personally go through and pick and choose and say, these are good, these are bad, these are just, you know, human interpretations, and that's what we did a long time ago, but we don't need to do that anymore.
They certainly do that. But then the woman who wrote you that letter,
true.
For her, there's no difference.
Yeah.
Anything, you do anything wrong, and it's the worst crime of all.
Yeah.
They're all the same.
Yeah.
There are two kinds of believers. One is that everything in the Bible is true. It's all literally true.
Yeah.
And to me, they're the biggest ones to talk about because, again, there's so many contradictions in the Bible. And again, if you believe everything is true, then you should believe that somebody picking up sticks on the Sabbath should be stoned to death.
Yeah, they really get through some pretzels to get out of those type things.
And the other one as well, that's an interpretation. It's a metaphor. And once it's left up to each person's individual interpretation, what good is it?
Yeah.
It's absolutely no good because, again, they're going to have 2 million people. You can have 2 million gods.
Basically. When you're dealing with something as important and, important as eternal life and death and torture and reward, it's kind of more important. God should be able to lay it down specifically rather than through parables and stories and interpretations and metaphors. He better be freaking clear on it.
Yeah.
It's not a metaful man. There's going to be a four-headed beast.
Okay.
I'm looking forward to that. That's going to be so cool. I want to turn on the news and see a four-headed beast rampaging through New York City.
I've got to go buy the awesome camera just so I can record that.
It'd be like, you know, Japanese giant monster movies come to life.
Exactly.
Anyway, good show. I guess I'll let you go. We'll talk to you later.
Okay.
Bye. All right.
Thanks for calling.
And I want to make it clear, I am not angry with God, but ministers piss me off. I think that they are charlatans, hucksters, and ripoff artists, though a lot of them don't understand that that's what they are.
Yeah.
And I think they need to get real jobs.
Okay. All right. With that note, on to, I assume we're going to go with Mike. How are you doing?
Mike,
are you there? Apparently not. Mike. Okay, so drop that. Okay, sorry. Let's go to Terry. How you doing?
Hello. How are you?
Hi, Terry.
Pretty well.
You know what? Thank God for you guys.
Who?
Thank God. You know what? And not the guy that was just talking, but the guy before him.
Yeah.
He's one that's very ignorant, and I'm from Houston, and I was flipping the channels, and the last time I was in Austin, I seen you guys, and I said, you know what? You know what? I'm glad you guys have enough sense to tell the people. And you know, it's the Christian community that is very ignorant because they don't know that Constantine, before Rome was Christian, which Rome was the first Christian church in the Western Hemisphere, before they persecuted Christians until the Emperor Constantine said, all of Rome is Christian now. Uh-huh. And then that's how it spread.
And
like you was Jeff was saying about the Bible, before you can quote the Bible to me, you got to prove that that Bible is a divine book.
Exactly.
We all know that God didn't stick his hand out of heaven and write the Bible itself. Even Christians admit that another man told another man, hey, a higher power told me to write these words. And that other man took that other man, and if you go back to ancient history, even before Abraham started the Jewish race, the Egyptians had a culture before Christianity, and the Christianity and Judaism is Jewish mythology. And it was because if it wasn't for Constantine, we'd probably be worshiping Zeus and Hercules.
Well, actually, you want another really cool little factoid? You'll love this. You know how the story of the fall of Rome is all about these pagans that came sweeping in to destroy Rome? You know what was really going on? Constantine didn't just make all of Rome Christian. He made all of Rome a particular flavor of Christianity. The Visigoths, who were the invaders that sacked Rome, they were Christians too. They were just a different kind who weren't the official legal kind of Christians. And they were pissed off because Rome enforced religious tolerance, and Constantine swept that away.
Yeah. Right, and I believe what you were saying,
Christianity
Jeff,
destroyed Rome, not
right,
pagans.
What you were saying, Jeff, about people telling you that you're going to go to hell just because you don't believe, I agree with you 100%, Jeff, that I'm very insulted when someone tried, because you're right, they use that as a scare tactic. You know what I'm saying?
And sure. I tell people, it's a carrot and a stick.
Well, you know what I tell
but
people?
The funny thing is, it's a carrot and a
stick. If I believe in Christianity, I'm going to hell. You know what I tell them? I said, have you died and went to hell? How do you know? When you die and you go back and you go and you got and you come back and you can prove to me. And he says, well, what about those people that had out-of-body experiences? But like you said, Jeff, that's hallucination.
Yep.
Because
yep.
if they, I'm not saying we know that God is not white, black, or whatever. But if you notice, it's mostly all the white people that have had these hallucinations. They all said that they've seen a white being. So and so I'm a firm believer that if God does exist, the fact that a certain race portrays God as another race would be very disrespectful, especially since the Christians say they're trying to get people, that the Bible and Jesus said that you're supposed to bring people to the religion. Well, there's a lot of young black men who are angry who say, well, if that's the deal, well, then that Jesus can't be for us if this is what they... So the point I'm trying to make is I agree with you, Jeff, when you said that no one can say that you're going to go to this place, heaven or hell, that's never been dead before. Like you said, what does faith mean? Yeah. Faith means hope.
Prove
like
any of this
said,
stuff exists.
You can
exists.
Have faith that your paycheck's coming tomorrow morning.
Doesn't make it true.
It don't mean it's going to come. Yeah. It could get lost in the mail, but you can be very positive about that situation. There are people that are sick.
Prove any of it exists.
They have cancer, and they pray, and they're sick. If they get healed, everybody thinks, oh, my God, it was Jesus or God. Yeah. But do you know there's way more people that get sick and pray and never get well?
Yeah. Here's another little factoid. There's this place in Europe, Lourdes, right? Yes. In the Catholic Church. This is a big deal, right? It's where there was a miracle and there's healings. Bunches and bunches of people every year go to Lourdes to get miracle cures. Because they think it's a special place, they're going to get miraculously cured. You know what? Statistically, more people die on the way from plane crashes and car crashes on the way to Lourdes for a miracle cure than people have gotten cures that the Catholic Church is willing to call miraculous.
Right. And I'm glad you brought the Catholic Church up because they have so many customs that I tell people all the time, you know, a lot of stuff that you do, even if God did exist, like you said, Jeff, if it was true, there's something ain't right somewhere. And like you said, Jeff, we don't know, as humans, we only know so much. If God did exist, there's something that we're doing that's wrong in religion, and there's too many. I mean, no God would let wars and people starve. No God would invent different races of people where. I mean, I know it's not good for everybody to be the same, but I'm like you, Jeff. Science has a better explanation about how the world got here than religion. Religion sounds like fantasy. And science doesn't know everything, like you said. But like you said, when Edison invented the light bulb, if he would have said, okay, I got a light bulb over here, and he never proved it, he never showed nobody, but he showed people, they seen it with their eyes, boom, that was proof.
Okay.
But thank you guys very much.
Yep. Okay, all right.
And I'm going to join your organization, and I'm going to support it financially. Writing all this information down. Cause,
that's awesome.
And like you said, thank God for you guys. Duh.
Okay, all right. Thanks for calling.
Thank you.
Good. Yeah, which one?
All right. All right, quick note. Again, we are sponsored by Atheist Community of Austin. We have weekly meetings every Sunday at Crescent City Beignets, which is, again, on 6th Street, a little bit west of Lamar. That is it for callers. One last thing, actually, I wanted to get at, too. He was mentioning Constantine and turning Rome Christian, stuff like that.
Yeah.
Constantine, apparently, is also the one who came up with December 25th being the birth of Christ. And the reason that he did that on December 25th was because of Mithraism.
Uh-huh.
Took over Mithraism, who was another god, who was born on December 25th,
and blah, 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 blah. Pretty much a duplicate of Christianity. Yeah. Anyway, thank everybody for watching. Thank you very much, Jeff, for coming on and being a co-host. Russell Glasser is going to be our co-host next week. And everybody, those are our love rings. We thank everybody for watching. Have a great rest of the week.